I want to talk about TMS or rTMS in the treatment of depression, and the title is that I'm moving from the standard treatment of TMS to the more modern ways of treatment, or exactly the title is from high frequency rTMS to E-field guided theta burst stimulation in the treatment of depression. So I guess most of you are not from the field of psychiatry, so the question might be, why is it necessary to treat depression with TMS, as we have good treatments like medication or psychopharmacology or also psychotherapy? The problem is that, first of all, we have a lot of people with depression, so the prevalence is very high. And the second point is that even if we have good treatments, it's not the case that every patient responds from this treatment at all. So every fifth patient has no response to medication or also to psychotherapy. And even in the patients who respond, we have not a full remission. So there is a need for alternative treatments in depression. So, and one alternative treatment might be non-invasive brain stimulation. So let's go into the literature. We have the first studies published in 1995, and since that we have over 2,000 publications with respect to this topic. So this is one of the most investigated field in psychiatry and or in TMS in psychiatry. We have since 2008 the first approval, FDA approval in the US, and in the last years other countries are following. So this is the status from reimbursement, or from more political point of view, that you can get reimbursed your treatment. And with respect to evidence or to science, we see, if you look at in the evidence-based guidelines, that TMS in depression is definitively effective, which is a more qualitative response. And if you look at the meta-analysis, we have some kind of evidence that it might be at least as effective as some of our antidepressants we use. So we have a good alternative. And the basic idea was how to treat depression, that there were some findings from PET or early fMRI that we have some prefrontal disbalance, meaning that we have an hypoactivation of the left prefrontal cortex and an hyperactivation of the right prefrontal cortex. So the initial idea was to stimulate with an activating protocol the left prefrontal cortex. And this is the present status of treatment of depression with TMS. So we stimulate the left dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, targeting or localizing the coil according to some kind of skull landmarks or some kind of EEG points. So it's very rough. We do not really know where we stimulate. We normally use figure of eight coils with a high frequency protocol, 10 or 20 hertz. Sessions last about 20 to 30 minutes. We apply 1,000 to 3,000 pulses per day, and a normal treatment lasts between 3 and 6 weeks, and the intensity is above threshold. And if you look in the efficacy, we see that about 30% of our patients are responders. And if you look at the literature, these are almost patients who were treatment resistant. So at least one medication trial failed. So this is the status. And of course, we are scientists and we want to develop things further. And I want to give you just two examples here in this talk, how we can develop this further. And one example is we should try to do navigation. The second thing is we try to do other stimulation protocols, and one is the theta burst stimulation. And about these two topics I will talk today. So the first one is the neuronavigation. You all know this. I would guess. We have an about millimeter accuracy. We can improve reliability and validity of coil position. And of course, this is very important. So standard is that we have some kind of so-called scientific head caps, which are marked with the treatment position. But you can guess this will vary from day to day. We also do not really know where we stimulate. And if we use neuronavigation, we can have better reliability, better validity, and we can also control the position during the treatment. Yeah, so we can see if the target was always reached or was reached by each single stimulus which was given. The problem is, so it sounds very good to use neuronavigation, but the problem is, of course, we have to investigate this because we have more costs, I would say. We have to do an fMRI. We have maybe also more expensive machines. So we have more costs. And is this more costs accompanied with higher efficacy? So it is necessary to investigate if neuronavigation in a treatment approach is really an advantage. So, and there are only a limited amount of papers published. One is published in 2009 by Fitzgerald, and he could show in about 50 patients with depression that the neuronavigation approach is superior to the standard localization approach. A second depression, second study was published some weeks ago, where the contrast between neuronavigation, also the standard position according to skull landmarks, was only a side issue of this paper, and they do not really see a significant difference between the 5 centimeter estimation method, a specific localization method, and the neuronavigation method. So this was negative, and also for tinnitus, a similar thing was done where the auditory cortex was stimulated, so there also was no difference between these two localization methods. So it's necessary to investigate this. And of course, we have also open questions, which might be a problem, not of the machine builders. The problem, of course, is that we do not really know the exact position or the exact location of depression. So this might vary from patient to patient. It's not clear. So the important thing is in the future to develop the techniques more better to implement also functional MRI, things like that, that we have more personalized approaches. And also one matter of debate is, of course, which kind of navigation should we use, just guide anatomically or functionally, or should we use e-field, which is also a matter of debate. So a second further development is theta burst stimulation. And theta burst stimulation means that we stimulate with bursts in a theta range. So I think the pointer does not work, or is it working? Ah, it's working. So with theta burst stimulation, we apply triplets or bursts of three pulses in a 5 hertz way, which is this theta, so it's called theta burst stimulation. And depending if we do this continuously or intermediately, we have different protocols. And for depression, is the idea to use this iTBS protocol on the left prefrontal cortex. And the advantage is that theta burst stimulation is much more faster than the continuous protocols. And the field was stimulated by this work of Bloomberger, who showed that we have non-inferiority of iTBS against the standard protocol. The standard protocol was 10 hertz. That means that we have a faster protocol, so which lasts 3 minutes per session against 20 minutes for 10 hertz or 20 hertz stimulation. So this might be a thing of interest to investigate further. We have also comparable tolerability between these two kind of stimulation, 10 hertz and iTBS. One problem is that the subjective pain ratings below the coils were a little bit higher, so that for example, the target intensity was reached later during the treatment. So it's a little bit more intensive from discomfort. The big advantage, as I told you, is we have shorter stimulation time. The consequence was also FDA approval, but if you look at the literature, we have a lot of studies missing. And if we can say something about evidence or evidence-based guidelines, we have a probable efficacy of bilateral TBS, but not of this unilateral TBS on the left frontal cortex. That means we should investigate this theta burst stimulation, and we should investigate also neuronavigation. So, and this is the idea of our study I want to shortly show, that that we want to investigate the e-field guided iTBS in depression. This trial is registered in clinical trials, and we allocate in a randomized controlled trial 40 patients in one arm, 40 patients in the other arm. One arm is e-field guided stimulation of the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, and the second arm is we localize the coil according to an EEG position, which is assumed to lie over the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. And I want to show you today the first results. I will not resolve which is the study arm, because it's blinded. And what I want to show is, these are our 15 patients so far we have included in this trial with localization A and B. It's blind, I do not really know it. But what we see is that we have, for this e-field-guided iTBS, a decrease in the Hamilton scores from baseline to week 4 of about 9.5 in both arms. So we have no difference with respect to the location method. But what we see is, if we compare this to our historical control sample, that means we, for the last 15 years, where we treated over 300 patients, it's not completely comparable, because it's open treatments, meaning that we have stimulation days from 6 to up to 40 or things like that. But this is a mean improvement of our patients in the last 15 years, and it's a little bit smaller. So these are our first results. So we have a good response with the neuronavigation device. We see also four dropouts, and I would guess that only one is really directly related to the treatment, which was too unpleasant. I think this was in the beginning. Now, if time goes on, the patients are more open for this treatment, and it's some kind of mouth-to-mouth communication within the patients in the hospital. So it's very good tolerated, I would say. But we can affirm this findings from Bloomberger that the iTBS is more discomfort than the continuous stimulation. So these are our first results. So to conclude this, our findings or using this neuronavigation device are very, very promising, I would say. But of course, we are waiting for the interim analysis, which will be done after 40 patients. So this is the topic of my talk, was e-field guided iTBS in depression. But what I want to emphasize is, these are only two things we can further develop. There are a lot of other things we can develop further, and things are, well, it's not the end of the road. And to give you a perspective, what about robot assistance? So is it necessary that we mechanically hold the coil? These are things we have to develop further. I would say, what about multi-site stimulation? Not only stimulate one area, what about stimulating more areas of a depressive or depression network in the brain? What about accelerated protocols? We have protocols who apply the same dosage within 1 week, not over 4 weeks. What about maintenance therapy? So there is limited literature how to maintain a treatment effects after this intensive treatment period. What about different coil types, stimulation parameters? So there are also all other things in addition to iTBS or TBS we can investigate. And I think two things which will be the future is, how can we combine it with other therapies? So if we guess that rTMS is inducing some kind of neuroplasticity, or if I talk to my patients, we help your brain to learn. Your brain is a learning machine. So it's necessary for the future to say the brain what to learn. Yeah. So how can we combine this with psychotherapy, with relaxation techniques, things like that? This will be the future, I think. And also personalization, like combining TMS with information from fMRI, from EEG. I think we will hear tomorrow from Michael Fox or Christoph Strenner how we can personalize rTMS in a treatment of depression. Okay, that's perspectives, but the big problem, I think, is that the standard is not established yet. So I think there are a lot of countries where we have not really a good or systematic reimbursement of the standard rTMS in depression. So scientists, of course, want to establish or wants to work on the perspectives, but I think there is also a lot of political work done to establish in all countries all over the world that TMS is really a good alternative to psychotherapy and also to medication. Thank you very much.